Hey Charles, have you heard of this blocked force thing?
Yeah, I heard a lot of people talking about it recently.
I do too, and I got to tell you, when I first learned about it, I was kind of confused what it was all about. So I developed a little explanation about it. You want to see if it makes any sense to you?
Very interested.
So, force, in a lot of the applications our customers are doing, they're trying to estimate force from displacements or accelerations. If you have a spring, which could be a mount or something in a vehicle or on a motor or whatever it happens to be, you could measure the acceleration on both sides, calculate displacement from that. And if you knew the spring rate of the spring and the relative displacement, you have F equals KX, and you can measure the forces pretty easily that way. Have you ever done that yourself, Charles?
Yeah.
So that's a great plan. And of course, this is a function versus frequency. So I always feel compelled to draw, even though they're bad drawings and I can't draw too straight here. But the force that we're looking at here, it might change as a function of frequency, right? We're dynamic people or dynamicists. And the force levels are not necessarily the same at every frequency, right? It can vary.
Definitely by the look of your drawing, they're varying.
They definitely are. All right. So that's good, except there's one little problem, and that's that, like, if I'm testing some sort of power source or motor or whatever in a test rig of some sort, this assumption here that there's no displacement or no movement on this side of the mount, I guess they call that the passive side of the mount, is not always true, right?
No, it's not.
The test fixture or the frame might have its own dynamics. It might have a spring rate, which could be more stiff, but nevertheless could interact. So this F equals KX assumption, is that true? Like, if I'm going to get my X from here and my F, calculate my F just using this stiffness?
No, not if we have interaction with another spring.
Yeah, it'd have to be a lot more stiff to have no interaction to look like this. And so now the force is really a combination of K1, K2 here, X2, X1. And we have to use all those terms to calculate the force. And so the forces that we might measure might not be fully reflective of the source item, the source item being the motor that's generating the force, for example. They might also reflect the fact that the test fixture or the vehicle or the application that holds the motor is not perfectly stiff. And so, yeah, it kind of depends. I think you alluded to it. If the two systems are strongly coupled or weakly coupled, if it's strongly coupled, they're interfering with each other. Can this change as a function of frequency, whether the two systems are strongly coupled or weakly coupled? What do you think, Charles?
I think you can.
Yeah. And so you'll see people try and build these really stiff test rigs because they want to measure the true forces coming from this rolling tire. And that's probably true at lower frequencies, but as we go up in frequency, there's more and more dynamics present in these FRFs. In other words, the chances that we have a mode in the structure gets higher as we go up in frequency. Does that kind of make sense?
That makes sense.
So this thing might be super dead or stiff at the low frequencies, but eventually we'll hit a high enough frequency that we will have interaction between the test rig and the source item, like in this case, the tire, and that will throw off our force estimation. And nowadays that's happening even more and more because a lot of these motors and things are electric motors. They spin at much higher frequencies. And so things where they were dead at, 1,000 hertz and below, we're talking about 4,000 hertz, 8,000 hertz, things like that, for where the electric motors might be operating and producing significant forces. I think that's why you're hearing more and more about it. It's because of electrification, Charles.
I see the challenge there.
Yeah. Okay, so let's talk about that a little bit more. This is where my simple explanations trying to come in here, Charles. I got these masses and springs. What does that create within these structure that you see here?
Natural frequencies.
Yeah, so this thing's going to resonate at certain frequencies, etc. And I kind of broke it up into a source system, you know, a motor or whatever, and a receiver system. So two of the masses and springs are on the receiver, and then we got some on the source here. And if you have a motor or whatever, there's forces that get generated internally that end up creating a response on the receiver system, this V4. And so by making a simplified system like this, but that has masses and springs, so I have natural frequencies, I can see the effect of a force that's input here and then calculate the response over here. I can also try to calculate a force coming out of the source system and into the receiver system. So we know that this force will generate a force in turn on the receiver system. One of the things that we'll try and do, if you can imagine, maybe you're simulating, so on the computer designing a motor, it might be hard to model all the windings and everything else to get the forces coming out of the source exactly right.
I agree.
But rather than model it, we could measure the force here by doing the displacement across the mount. And so we want to really kind of come up with an equivalent force for what's coming out of this source and into the receiver system. So that's part of the objective with this, we'll get to it, with the blocked force, is I want to replicate the response at V4. I want it to be the same, and I want to find a force that allows me to replicate V4 without having to really consider the force over here. Notice it's gone.
Okay.
All right. So there's a few ways you might do that. One way, I can plug in all these numbers for the masses, stiffnesses, dampings. I can then apply a force. So this is a function versus frequency at the input here to mass one. And then I can calculate V4. So this is my reference velocity, but it could be a pressure or an acceleration that's generated by a force applied here, and then it comes out over here on system R.
So reference, now, got it.
Now we're going to try and find this really special force that will also make the same response at V4. So here's one way we might do that. I go and I put F input here, I end up calculating the force. I take that force and I can apply it to this system with both the receiver and the source here, or I could apply it just to the receiver system. And notice this F input here, I got rid of it. There's no F input because we want that equivalent force that comes out of the source to replicate V4.
Yep, the one that's easier to measure.
And so what do you think, Charles, when we apply the force to just the receiver, or if we apply this force to the receiver and the source, will we end up matching V4?
I don't think it's going to match if we apply it to the source and the receiver together. I think it will if we just apply it to the receiver system.
Yeah. And so some people call this an interface force or a contact force. And you're right, Charles. If I went and did the calculations, because I got all the mass and the springs, the blue line, V4, was our reference from the combined system with this F input. And it matched when we applied the force just the system R. We got a line-on-line match. In fact, it's really hard to see, but we got blue on green there. Do you see it, that they overlay?
Yeah.
And when we applied it to the combined system SR, it totally didn't match. But this is not a blocked force, right? This force was calculated with both systems present. So it has some influence of R, has some influence of S, et cetera. Do you know how you calculate a blocked force?
You have to get rid of the influence of the receiver.
Yeah, it's the blocked force is going to be the invariant or the force that's coming out of system S alone. Again, this one did not match over here, but this one did. But a blocked force, it's going to look like this. You put this total constraint. You cannot move whatsoever here. Zero displacement, infinite mass, infinite stiffness, or whatever it is, theoretically. That force at the interface due to this F input is called a blocked force. It has that FB there. And then we kind of got the same question for you. I've calculated FB under this circumstance. I know what V4 should look like, but if I calculate FB here versus there, in which case do you think it'll match when we apply it to system R or to the combined system?
I'm going to say to the combined system this time.
You're going to go just because it's over here. This was the right answer before, so it probably the middle column. Set
the middle. Yeah, that's my strategy.
Yeah, there's a reason why we're showing the middle case, I guess. Yeah, so we want the case where this V4 matches the original system with the F input and everything else. And you were right, Charles. Here's that reference. And we can see that when we had just system R, it did not match at all. But when we applied the block force to the combined system SR, it did match. There's different circumstances. It makes sense. The block force and the contact or interface force, those are two different forces, right? They're not going to be the same functions. And so you probably can't apply them, so to speak, in the same way. So this didn't match. And notice where we calculated the FB. It was a little bit different than last time. It's the force coming out of this system. And that's convenient because people will use these component libraries where they'll have these source systems and they want to be able to attach them to things. So it's convenient to kind of have this as the interface for where the force is coming out. You don't have to have the mount along there as well. Not that you couldn't, but it's just kind of convenience. So we did shift where we also calculated the force here, and we shifted how we were calculating it. We constrained it. Now, where it becomes interesting is I might have a motor or something on a test rig on one continent, and then we're developing the application, a vehicle or a boat or whatever this motor is going to go into on a different continent. And they haven't seen each other. But we want to be able to predict the response of a new system. So watch what happens to R here. We're going to swap it into system T, and I got a new response here, V6. And it's new because I got an M6 and an M5. This was M3 and M4 before. So I've got a totally different.
Gotcha. Totally different masses.
Yeah, different masses, different springs. We still have our system S. That's the same. And I have a blocked force.
Force input's the same?
The force input's the same. So we had calculated a contact force before, and we had calculated a blocked force before due to that F input. And as I recall, when we did the contact force on the receiver system alone, we got a great match. And when we did the blocked force on the combined system, we got a great match for what V6 should be. Do you think we'll get a match from both of these situations, from this one and from this one?
I got a feeling that they're both aren't going to work out this time with the new receiver.
If you were to look at the data, this no longer works. So that contact force was dependent on the source and the receiver system, and you can't apply it to the new system, but the blocked force does work. So the blocked force on the combined system, you got green and blue, and those match right on top of each other. And then the contact force applied to system T alone does not match at all. It was nice to use these simpler mass spring representations, but this basically applies to any complex product. Hopefully, that made it a little easier to understand by taking this approach with these mass spring systems. Do you think it helped you, Charles?
I think it did. I can see the value of these block forces now, why they're so popular.
Yeah, because we can put these forces into new and different applications and predict the response correctly, which is helpful to actually predict it well. Here's a like a real world example, if you will, where we have a source system. It's this metal, silver metal plate that has three connections on it. Do you see it?
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah, we got it in one system where we calculate the blocked forces. And then we put it in a different system here. It still has its three connections. And we also calculated contact forces. If we use contact forces when we go to the new system, no match. See how terrible that is, Charles?
That's poor. That's a poor match.
Yeah. But with a blocked force, we got a great match, or a very much closer match for the same system. And so that just illustrates, you know, I guess a more real world application, why blocked forces are so important for predicting the correct response of a dynamic system as you move the source from application to application.
Thanks, Pete.
No, you're welcome, Charles. Hope that was helpful in explaining blocked forces.
Certainly was.